Hey, Jim.
Hey, Kristina. How are you?
I'm great. How are you doing?
Really, really well. So last night we saw the governor's State of the Commonwealth address. There's a lot packed into that, and I guess the our job here today is to have a little conversation around one aspect of that, and that's the transportation proposal that's embedded in it, which was referencing a proposal that was released earlier in the week. It's $1 billion a year plan for 10 years, $10 billion total, investing in transportation infrastructure. So what's your take on it?
Well, we've had a problem in Massachusetts for a long time that really hasn't been addressed by our leaders. So we at Transportation for Massachusetts are really delighted that the governor's taken a bold step forward, put forward a vision that would reach investment to all corners of the Commonwealth. I'm curious, what do you think about it?
You know, I think as an institute, we've always been big on public infrastructure, making sure that we can actually move people and goods. It's an integral part of economic development. I think part of it we like and a lot of it we don't like. I think it overstates a number of different things. We kind of get into that, but it's basically in terms of what our needs are, I think it overstates it drastically. And I think the negative impacts that are embedded in the tax proposals are probably they outweigh any kind of benefits you might get out of it.
Well, I'm glad that you brought up economic development, because that's one of the reasons why we're so supportive of the vision that the governor laid out. We know that our businesses really need good roads to get people back and forth to work and to get people to jobs. And we also know that in order for Massachusetts to be competitive, we need to keep up with the rest of the country. And there are states all over that are starting to make investments in their transportation infrastructure. So we believe that investing in a 21st century transportation system means we can have a 21st century economy.
Yeah, you know, when you think about how we got ourselves into this problem, though, essentially much of it went back to the big dig requirements for additional transit and other things that came with it. That's really what has driven much of what the T's debt load is made up of. And I fear that we should instead focus on fixing what we have first. It is absolutely essential to have the right kind of rolling stock track signalization for the T. And I do think some modest investments in that regard matched with some additional reforms within the T would be, I think, essential to do. And we've supported that. And we're willing to go to about $250 million a year through a mix of different revenue sources, mainly the gas tax, but some other things, about a 6% increase. I get very fearful when you have a system that is in disarray, where people in the winter, frankly, you're never sure if you get on the T whether you're going to be able to get to where you want to get. It may break down. When we have all of that to take care of, and then we say, well, we're going to build additional stuff. That's essentially the same recipe, if you will, that got us into this mess in the first place. We're the fastest growing transit system in the country over the last 20 years. I think we should really take care of what we've got already. That would be a much smarter way to go before saying, well, what we have kind of stinks, but let's build more.
Well, yeah, we fundamentally agree with you about that we need to take care of what we have and that that should be an absolute top priority. The bridges, we have a lot of bridges that are closed, that are restrained and restricted. I mean, and people even, like in Hudson, for example, there's a bridge that leads right to the downtown and people can't get to those businesses. I mean, it has a real economic cost to close down our bridges. And it's the same thing with public transportation. You know, in the metropolitan area in Boston, we have so many employees that get to the downtown of Boston through commuter rail, through subway, through the bus system, that if all of a sudden, if you can imagine a day when the transit system just shut down, what would happen? And we had little taste of that when we had so many commuter rail problems a couple winters ago when the trains just literally were not on time and people weren't able to get to work. So we agree with you on that piece, but we also feel like we can't stand still. Like we could become frozen in time if we don't improve our transportation infrastructure like places around the world and within the United States. And you mentioned the number $250 million, a very interesting number. I mean, we were looking at operating deficits right now. The T is facing a huge one next year, $140 million alone for the T. And MassDOT has almost double that. So we're starting to look at much more than $250 million that's needed. If you look at the capital plan, we've been starting to look at the plan that Governor Patrick released on Monday. And you know, most of the money, particularly in the early years, is dedicated just to dealing with the operating deficits that we have. And we've, you know, we've been borrowing money, you know, to pay for salaries and mowing the lawn and plowing the snow, which is unsustainable for our kids. I mean, it's fiscally irresponsible. I'm sure you and I can completely agree on that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, it's a real problem. It's like using your credit card to pay for your debt or your groceries, your rent or your groceries. So we need to stop that practice. We need to stop paying people with money that's meant for repairing our trains and buses. and instead paying salaries. So that's one issue for us. And so the numbers are actually, we think they're quite reasonable on the as you start to look at the deficit reduction that's needed, and then the maintenance backlog, which is substantial, much higher than what you said. But the most important point, I think, is that we can't not also improve our transportation in significant ways. And we know that editorial boards around the state have been calling for more investments. We've got the Springfield Viaduct that is not going to be safe, that needs to be repaired. It's like $350 million. We've got rail that's needed for Fall River, New Bedford. We've got rail that's needed out to Springfield. So these things are things that we need for our future economy.
That's where I think for us the argument breaks down. I mean, look, rail out to Springfield, why do you need that? Do you have ridership numbers to support that? I don't think you do at all. The studies that I've seen are not at all convincing. And I mean, just think about it for a second. Peter Pan, the bus service, is headquartered in Springfield. It's not like they're bulking up service to Boston, and there's an overflow and people waiting in line to get tickets to come to Boston. The same thing is true, and I know you're part of the South Coast Railing Project, and I applaud your work there and all the rest. But frankly, it's if you had $2 billion, and then you have to think about all the maintenance and repair that comes on top of that, which is not even in the governor's plan. In that sense, it's not at all a serious plan. It doesn't include maintenance or repair for any of these new projects. If you went to John Mitchell, the mayor of New Bedford, said, look, you've got $2 billion we're going to spend on this rail link to Boston, or we'll give you $500 million you could spend in your city for infrastructure, which one do you think he'd take? And I'm pretty convinced that he would probably take the $500 million that he could actually use to meet local needs rather than this pie in the sky, and frankly, from my perspective, perspective that's full of hubris about Boston, that everybody needs to be connected to Boston. Look, I grew up in Rhode Island and spent a ton of time in New Bedford and Fall River. There are many more connections to Rhode Island currently in terms of transportation, pathways for people going back and forth to work than there are to Boston. This is pie in the sky stuff when we should take care of what we have already, fix those bridges in Hudson, fix the bridges across the state, fix the what the T has, address our current needs. We've already grown for two decades, fastest in the country. We have a stagnant population. And yet, we think that we're going to have these economic drivers of what? Invest $1, get $2 of economic benefits is what the governor is basing his plan on in part. That's baloney. That's outsized expectations.
Yeah, I understand where
and
you're coming from.
Take into consideration the negative impact of taxes.
Yeah.
There are negative impacts of taxes, though. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I was going to say that I understand what you're saying about low ridership projects, but I think it's a really narrow metric that you're using to understand what the impact of these projects can be. Now, for example, South Coast Rail, I worked on that for a while, and we looked at the regional impact. We'd have to ask the mayor what he would prefer, $500 million or $2 billion, but my guess and my work down there indicates that people really see that project as a way to unlock economic opportunity. And we did a study at the time that showed that just getting people connected to employers, just increasing the mobility that between employers and employees generates $500 million in new economic activity every year. So when you make that kind of investment, it's a down payment on the future. And we don't need to debate every single project, and we probably don't agree on all the different projects. But the point that I would like to make is that we need more rail. We need more less congested highways. We need these infrastructure improvements for a better economy. And if we don't make those investments, then it's short-sighted of us. Now, if we look at the governor's plan again, you know, we have these big operating needs. We have these big maintenance needs, and the bulk of the money is going to that. And these other projects are a small portion. So, for example, in the first year in our analysis, about $18 million is going to be used for expansion of capital projects. It ramps up over time, but the big bulk and the priority, the time, focus, the sequencing is all about maintenance and getting rid of our operating deficits right now. It's only about 1% of next year's budget would actually go to start planning these capital expansions.
Right. The overall plan, though, has about, 65% of it is for maintenance and repair, and another 35% is for expansions. But the governor's plan does not even put into his plan maintenance repair for these new projects. So if you put that into it, it's more like a 55-45 split over the 10-year term in favor of maintenance repair. I want to see 90%. I want to see 90% going to maintenance repair up until the point where we go from about 10 to 12% of our bridges that are deficient, which is about the national norm, but bring it down to 5 or 6%, because I think that's a competitive advantage for Massachusetts. But until we get to that place, until the T gets to a state of good repair, I don't want to hear about the new projects. I just think it's like,
if you look at, you've got your wish for next year. You've got your wish for next year. You've got 99%.
I'm not going to buy into a 10-year plan on a one-year basis. No way.
Yeah, but if you're looking at, even it's ramping up very slowly. So our analysis is very different than yours, and we'll have to wait for some more details out there. But it's like 1% for next year, and it's ramping up. And we agree. We need to take care of what we have. But it takes a long time to get these projects going. I know from working on South Coast Rail, it takes years of gestation and planning. And you need to get going on it now in order to have those pieces of infrastructure in place for the future. So if you just kind of take a blind eye and say, hey, we're not going to do anything right now, then you're really setting our kids up for failure in the future.
Absolutely not. I think you're absolutely, from the other side, setting our kids up for failure in the sense that you think through these projects that have multiplier effects that are exaggerated, that, frankly, Jim Rooney at the convention center would be proud of the ripple effects you guys are claiming. What you're doing is you're taking money out of people's pockets they would actually use for their kids' own education, sometimes send them to Catholic schools that have lower tuitions, et cetera, but they will not be able to do that.
Well, Jim, I've been all around the state.
You're taking money out of their hands for things they want to do with their kids.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, but without good transportation, kids can't get to good education. They're not going to be able to get to good jobs. It's not good for their future if we don't have decent transportation. I have been all around the state talking to editorial boards, and the Springfield Republican, the Worcester Telegram and Gazette, the New Bedford Standard Times, the Berkshire Eagle, the Cape Cod, all of these papers are coming out and say, we need this investment for our future. So, I mean, and we're hearing it. You know, I was in a meeting the other day with a grandmother who said that her son had just had to walk away from a job because he wasn't able to get there. You know, so we are really endangering not only the future of our kids, but a lot of people right now who cannot access opportunity without better transportation.
I guess I'd probably leave the kids out of this one because I don't think it just has as much to do with the kids. And frankly, that's a longer conversation. I don't think we should trot kids out for everything we're talking about.
Well, I'm not trying to do that. I think that's kind of an unfair thing because if you look at how we have so much debt right now, those, our children, and this is not an exaggeration, our children are going to be paying for Secretary Davies' salary unless we do something about this. So it's not. I think it's important for us to be thinking about the future and future generations.
Oh, absolutely. But we've just gone through a 20-year cycle where we've expanded faster than any other place in the country. We have a stagnant population. And I think we have to take stock of the fact that we've dug ourselves into a big, big hole.
That's agreed.
Fill that hole in, make sure we're out of that, and then we can start thinking about that. Until we really get to a place where we're much, much closer to closing that gap, I think it's really unwise to say, let's dig a few more holes in the hope that maybe we'll get some economic development out of it.
Yeah, well, I think we probably exhausted this to death, but I did want to, I mean, I think we're just on different sides of this, but I think it, you know, and we've both made good points, and I'll acknowledge that.